Chapter 16 is about America's Gilded Age. So really this deals a lot with industrialization and the reaction to industrialization. So first, you have this changing definition of the West or the Western frontier, what is considered the West throughout American history. And you'll notice that the maps I have in the back of my classroom that start in 1790 and work their way forward until the 49th and 50th states were admitted in 1959, and you can see gradual Western movement. So the period of early colonial settlement prior to 1700 is really more like pockets of civilization right along the Atlantic coastline. Up until the Revolutionary period, people were heavily settled up to and including the Appalachian Mountains, but not beyond. Particularly because, if you remember the proclamation line at the end of the French and Indian War, the Seven Years' War, known globally and in Europe, that the British Empire had told all of its colonists they could not move beyond the Appalachian Mountains. Then you get into the early Republic after the fighting of the Revolution. The western border moves from the Appalachian Mountains to the Mississippi River after the British reached their 1783 Treaty of Paris settlement with the new United States, granting all of the Northwest Territory as well up to the Mississippi River. Then you have Manifest Destiny and the expansion to the Pacific. And now, throughout this Gilded Age, Western movement picks back up again after it briefly paused a bit during the Civil War because of the turmoil of the Civil War. So this is your changing definition of what is considered the West. Now, we've already talked about in our Foner discussion the Homestead Act and Morrill Act. The Homestead Act was geared towards individual citizens, encouraging them to move west. They could earn 160 acres of federal land. It was known as homestead land. And if you got this land, you were a homesteader. And even the poor could get land in this system, and this is to encourage Western settlement. Now, the Morrill Act was also the granting of land, but it was the granting of land to colleges, and it was so that these colleges would teach farmers how to increase crop yields using new techniques, new technologies. We'll come back to this in a little bit. So these efforts were made, you'll notice, in the middle of the Civil War in 1862, while the Republicans had full control of Congress because so many of the Democrats had seceded and become part of the Confederacy. So it was easy for the Republicans to achieve these initiatives during the Civil War. Now, how is it that these lands become referred to as open? Well, the Dawes Act, which was passed in the 1880s, 1887, I want to say, in particular, natives were encouraged to become farmers. And when natives rejected the idea of abandoning nomadic culture, particularly Western native tribes were nomadic like this, the lands were taken from them and sold as surplus land to white settlers because it was viewed that they were not taking advantage of becoming farmers like had been encouraged in the Dawes Act. So you can see here to the right the loss of land to white settlement. And you can see in 1850, most of the West is considered land for exclusively Native Americans. And by 1865, You're seeing particularly the gold rush having drastically increased the amount of settlement on the West Coast. By 1880, you're seeing even less land remaining and being considered to be Native American land. And then, as you can see, a modern snapshot from 1990, very little remained by the late 20th century. You can see on these visuals an advertisement for what these surplus or supposedly surplus lands were being sold for, and the average price per acre. In some places, such as Colorado, for example, you could get surplus land for $7.27 an acre. And even the most expensive land in Washington State was $41.37 an acre. A wide variety of land and a wide variety of what was considered more valuable, but even lower class people could afford to try their hand at running a farm. You can see here too, and it's a little blurry the wording above, but the pile of human and horse bones left over from the Battle of Little Bighorn in 1876. And this is really kind of a microcosm of white settlement pushing natives off of their land, and then natives responding to that with sometimes violence. And in this case, the Battle of Little Bighorn, Custer was actually looking to ride into this territory, and he wanted to kill large numbers of Native Americans, and it in fact didn't end up obviously working out in his favor. He was a little arrogant in his tactics, and kind of backfired, blew up in his face. But nonetheless, this violence all stems to white settlement encroaching on native land and natives responding to what they viewed as an invasion of territory that they had been promised by the government. Now, these Western settlers that are given this supposedly surplus land, how do they fare? How do they make out? Well, new inventions actually spark new levels of production hardly seen before. So not only are new tactics like crop rotation changing the agricultural industry, but so are new inventions. You can see here a sample of from a museum of one of the original steel bottom plows invented by John Deere, and that obviously became a modern tractor company. And you can see here it being put on display for farmers, encouraging them to buy it. Then you have Cyrus McCormick invented the mechanical reaper that could be towed by a couple of horses and would harvest wheat much faster and more efficiently than a bunch of people with sickles doing it by hand. And the McCormick Company became McCormick Deering, eventually McCormick Deering Farmall, and all of that was bought up and is now owned by Case International. Now, small farmers, however, they end up suffering in this new environment. Despite the cheap land, operating a farm is still a huge cost up front. Even though the land was free, things like machinery, buildings, a house and barn, the seed to plant, livestock to raise, all this needed to be purchased before a farm could get off the ground. So this increased mechanization, and that's the term used to describe the use of these newer technologies, caused farm production to skyrocket. That also leads to prices plummeting. So you've got climbing costs and plummeting prices. That is a recipe for disaster. So this leads to absolutely crushing debt. And as these debts climbed, more and more farms are being foreclosed on by the banks. And this can be well depicted. This is actually a chart taken directly from a Regents exam, and corn production and prices. So you see corn production from just after the Civil War, about 5 years after, in 1870, is down here at probably 1,150 million bushels, so right about here. And then by the turn of the 20th century, after all of this mechanization, that has more than doubled, or nearly doubled. And you could see that here. What happens to prices? Well, you almost see the opposite curve here. As production increases, price decreases. As production tailed back off in the 1880s and into the 1890s, prices go up a little bit. And then you see a massive increase in production again, which leads to a big downturn in prices by the turn of the century. And this second increase plus the decrease in prices, increase in production, decrease in prices, was mainly due to Bonanza Farms. Bonanza Farms could own much more territory and much better equipment and much more equipment, excuse me, to cultivate, plant, and harvest land. And so Bonanza Farms buy out the little guy that's getting foreclosed on. So they just get gobbled up, and now you have big corporate farms. And that's really the trend even today, is big corporate farms muscling out small farms. You can see an image from the TV show Bonanza on the top right, very popular TV show. And bottom right is a depiction of a Bonanza farm harvesting a huge amount of wheat. And you can count here at least a dozen mechanical reapers. So here's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, and there's probably more in the distance that we can't even count. But even if it was a dozen, that is an insanely large farm, particularly for this time period. Another thing that happened is what was once the open range for ranchers is now being closed off to protect farm fields from being trampled by cattle. A man by the name of Lucian Smith invented barbed wire in 1867. It was very, very tedious and time-consuming to produce, so not very many people used it. However, barbed wire became extremely popular when a man by the name of Joseph Glidden filed a patent in 1874 on a machine that he had made out of a coffee grinder, actually, that could mass produce it. So you would slide a piece of fencing wire in and use the coffee grinder to wrap a smaller piece of wire around every couple of feet to produce the barbed wire. And so Joseph Glidden popularized barbed wire, even though it had been invented earlier, and really just because it became easier to produce than in the past. And so by the end of the 19th century, most farms had put up barbed wire fences to keep the free-ranging cattle from destroying their crops. And so ranching really changes a lot, too. It goes from an open range moving across hundreds, if not thousands of miles, to the meat markets in Chicago. So what you would see and what a lot of old Western films and TV shows are about are ranchers that would they would raise cattle in, say, Texas, and then they would have huge cattle drives up to the rail lines in like Kansas and Nebraska, and then the rail lines would take the cattle to Chicago for meat processing. That's like the headquarters of the meat processing industry in the US at the time. And that all really ended. And so you went from that open range concept to a more closed in, fenced in ranch like you see today. So where do the farmers turn? Well, you can kind of see here in this chart that is taken directly from Foner's book that farmers who had been foreclosed on need to make a living still. They need to take care of their families. So a lot of people moved to the city for factory work. So between 1870 and 1920, with a kind of check-in in the middle of 1900, you can see the amount of land being farmed by millions of acres is drastically increasing. So is the production of wheat, hence the lowering of prices, which only exacerbates the foreclosures. But then you also see an explosion in manufacturing employment as cities industrialize and offer good paying factory work to people, or decent paying factory work. We're going to get into the labor movement here shortly. But you see the percentage of industries working in the agricultural industry, you had 52% of the population. Then you only have 27% 50 years later. Whereas in heavy industry, you have 29%, climbs all the way to 44% 50 years later. Trade, service, administration, so like the service economy. That only went up slightly, so a lot of the shift from agricultural went directly to industrial work. You also see a massive increase in railroad track around the country after the building of the Transcontinental Railroad and spider webbing off of that Transcontinental Railroad. The amount of steel to support heavy industry is drastically increasing. And GNP, gross national product, so what is being produced, what is made in the United States, what is its value in billions of dollars, from just over $7 billion to almost 19 to almost $100 billion. So just drastic increase in industrial capacity. And then per capita, you could see the numbers also climbing. Life expectancy is increasing as there's more industrialization. There's also more access to doctors. When you move to a city, there's probably a doctor closer to you than if you once lived off in the country. So people are getting more medical attention. So life expectancy increases as well. So what are the keys to this kind of economic growth? We actually talked about this once before in our discussions on the market revolution, and that is transportation and communication. The faster that you can move a good, the more of it you can sell. Sometimes that causes a drop in prices, but with the sheer quantity of what you sell, you make up for that lower price by selling exorbitantly more of the product. And then again, communication. So if you picture a Western town in the 1880s, there's usually a main building in the town that houses multiple things, like the local bank, the local post office, the local train station, the local telegraph office. And you could order from a growing business known as the Sears and Roebuck catalog. And William Sears had worked for the railroad, and he saw the potential for using the railroad with having warehouses kind of scattered around the country. He saw the potential to make money in a mail order catalog system. And so the Sears, Roebuck, and Company just grew exponentially in this time period because, particularly, people living in the West and far removed from the ability to easily shop for things would place their orders either through the postal service, or if they really wanted fast service, they could telegraph it back to the headquarters of Sears, Roebuck and Company in Chicago, and then receive their goods that much faster. What is the comparison here that I'm making with modern Amazon.com? Well, really, Amazon is the 21st century Sears, Roebuck and Company. The only real difference is better transportation and communication capabilities. You're seeing, historically speaking, Sears has declared bankruptcy. There is still a Sears website, but to my knowledge, there are not very many Sears physical locations anymore like there once were. Sears was a gigantic, gigantic, very wealthy company, but it kind of died out because of its lack of adjustment to a modern economy, and Amazon takes its place because Amazon, obviously the internet is the new communication speed. It's instantaneous. You place an order, they already have that order, it's already being processed. Then transportation, modern movement of things, not only on trains, yes, some things move still on trains, obviously delivery trucks in regional warehouses and then local delivery, but obviously being able to fly goods also speeds things up. So Amazon is really just a 21st century Sears. Now, how is this kind of industrial growth possible? Well, you can summarize it in three quick words that then help remind you of what those words represent: land, labor, and capital. So land stands for any raw material, not just land like you're farming it, but any raw material that is available on that land as well, like iron ore, coal, and oil, which were all necessary for business in this time period and remain an important part of business today, even if it's we transition to different types of energy production. And then labor, in the human energy and skill needed. Again, not just in farming and production of necessities like food, but also in industry. In the post-Civil War era, freed slaves and a huge increase in immigrants led to an excellent source of cheap labor for business. And then lastly, capital, tools, machines, money to pay for those tools and machines, wealth. So this dates all the way back to the idea of Alexander Hamilton's financial plan, Henry Clay's American system, and fostering capital investment, fostering economic growth. Patent laws encourage entrepreneurs to invent things, because if you patent it, then you will be wealthy when other people want to use your patent. So rich people like Rockefeller and Carnegie would reinvest a lot of what they had made into growing and expanding their business, which made them extremely rich, but also made the nation that much more of an industrial powerhouse in the world, and provided factory work in the cities when you had farmers leaving the countryside and going to the cities in huge numbers, as I showed you in that chart before. So everything kind of was working in harmony to grow the American economy. Now, the little guy doesn't make out so good in that system, and we're going to come back to that here in a little bit. How does the U.S. continue to grow its economy in a seemingly limitless or endless way? We did so nationally here at home by department stores selling goods to urban residents, mail order catalogs like Sears and Roebuck selling to rural residents, but eventually you're going to kind of expand to a limited point at that point. This is where U.S. imperialism comes into play, and our discussion of things like the Spanish-American War. So Western Europe, Japan, and the U.S. were competing for control of international markets all around the world, conquering or sponsoring coup d'etats to install a favorable government in another country, allowed for more control, And you can see this depiction here from 1898 after the United States defeated Spain in the Spanish-American War. We gained Puerto Rico. Cuba had gained its independence. We also had gained the Philippines. You can see Manila, which is the capital of the Philippines, over here, and the wings of the American Eagle seeming to cover the globe. So American imperialism was really more opening up international markets to U.S. goods than anything else. And the government also viewed it as a way of protecting American national security, because one of the ways that you maintained standing as a global power in this time was to have an extremely strong navy. And in order to have that navy be a threat to other nations that would protect your national security, you needed naval bases around the world, hence gaining territories like the Philippines and Hawaii. And how are these growth sectors managed? Well, corporations are huge businesses. So a lot of times businesses merge, they get bought out. That eventually too is referred to vocabulary wise as a trust, where multiple companies have merged. Now, laissez-faire capitalism, laissez-faire is French for hands off, and it just means that little to no government intervention or burdening taxation would encourage investment and growth in the economy. This is very much the attitude towards economics in the late 1800s and into the early 1900s. The problem is that leads to monopolies. Some of these trusts end up gaining full control of an entire industry. This ends up leading to government intervention. And this government intervention really is the government and society recognizing that laissez-faire in its purest form can't be sustainable. And so there needs to be a certain amount of government intervention. Now, how is the monopoly business model portrayed in examples from history? Well, the first ever real monopoly was railroad pooling. All these different railroads that competed with each other all of a sudden agreed on high prices that they would all charge. And they kind of chopped up the United States into regions. You have control of this region, I'll have control of this region. And the other thing too is charging more for a short haul than a long haul. So if you were going a longer distance, you actually got charged less than if you were going a shorter distance. And so really this just turned into a railroad monopoly. Then of course you have famous examples like John D. Rockefeller and Standard Oil. Lots of brutal business tactics used by Rockefeller to gain full control. He would get special sweetheart deals on things like railroad transportation rates, and when other companies went belly up because they couldn't keep up with him and all the sweetheart deals he had going on with the railroad tycoons, well then he bought up those companies, and eventually Standard Oil became a monopoly in the oil industry. Then you have Carnegie and Carnegie Steel, another famous example of a monopoly. Carnegie worked in a cotton mill as a teenager and only earned like 20 cents a day, and he grew into what was considered the wealthiest man in the world while he grew his steel industry. And he sold his company to J.P. Morgan in 1901 after 30 years in business for $480 million, and that is approximately $12 billion when adjusted for inflation and compared to more modern 2020 money. Now, obviously, I mentioned before the government sees a problem with monopolies. They want monopolies controlled. So they passed laws like the Sherman Antitrust Act to help attempt to control monopolies and those monopolies' influence over government. The vague language, however, made it very, very ineffective. You could see this very famous political cartoon of the steel beam trust, the copper trust, the oil trust. Some of these others are a little too blurry for me to read with it blown up for the slide like this, and the influence that these trusts had over the United States Senate. There's a rise of an American labor movement after Jacob Riis publishes his book, How the Other Half Lives. And for one of the first times, photography is being used. And it portrays images like this: tightly cramped tenement housing apartments. Tightly cramped tenement housing apartments. And this effective use of photography brought low wages and urban poverty to the forefront of the news. What does this lead to? Well, you have growing labor unions like the Knights of Labor, which really wasn't all that large because a lot of companies would simply fire all their u workers that were trying to unionize and hire different workers. And after a bombing in Chicago, in Haymarket Square, in 1886, the Knights of Labor gained a really, really bad reputation and ended up being kind of debunked. And what were they replaced with but the AFL, the American Federation of Labor, led by Samuel Gompers. It called for more civic participation in the workplace and needing to demand better from the government and from the industry, the industries in particular that had monopolies. So where our study of monopolies, businesses that grew completely into full control of an industry, the convergence of that with our also discussion of the rise of labor unions, the attention given to tenement housing, the living in poverty in the major cities. This kind of comes together nicely with learning about the Homestead Strike. The Homestead, PA steel plant, which was owned by Carnegie Steel, had unionized workers go on strike over a wage cut. The company called in what they referred to as security guards. And by name, they were known as the Pinkerton Detectives. But what they really were doing is bringing in hired mercenaries to put down the strike. Violence breaks out between the strikers and supposed guards, mercenaries for the in reality. And the federal troops had to break up the strike, and the union is set very far back. It didn't recover until the 1930s, when federal government policy under the Wagner Act, and we'll learn about that when we get to the 1930s, finally intervened on the side of workers. Here's a artistic depiction of the violence breaking out, but this was very bad. Many people were injured, many people were killed. This was labor and monopoly business tycoons coming to a head. In 1894, the Pullman strike was again about wage cuts of 25% that were not accompanied by lowering of rent or grocery prices in the company town. This is a term to know because many monopoly businesses had company towns where the company owned your home and rented it to you at what they called a discounted rate. But if they cut your wages and they don't lower your rent, obviously it's going to be hard to keep up. So anyway, the American Railway Union, which was led by Eugene V. Debs, they go on strike against any rail line that uses Pullman rail cars. And a federal court declares an injunction, which is essentially just a court order, against the union picketing. And eventually, President Grover Cleveland sends federal troops to end the strike, saying that it delayed the U.S. mail, which the government considered to be a federal offense. So in both of these instances, 1892 Homestead Strike and the 1894 Pullman Strike, the government is actually coming in on the side of business. In a major pro-business Supreme Court decision as well, you had U.S. versus E.C. Knight in 1895. Now, this is a sugar monopoly. They hands down have a monopoly over the sugar industry and sugar trade in the United States. However, the Supreme Court ruled that the trust could not be broken up, that the Federal Trade Commission did not have, nor did the Interstate Commerce Commission have any jurisdiction over the business, because it is not, in this case of the sugar trust, an interstate business, because all of the operations were contained within one state's lines, and that was the state of Florida. So the federal government was powerless. It would only be up to the state government to decide against the trust, and Florida was not going to do that because they made a lot of money off of their local taxes on the E.C. Knight Sugar Company. So, again, the federal government is deciding in favor of big business. In 1912, you have one of the first successful strikes, I would say. One of the first. The American Woolen Company workers go on strike to demand higher pay. Now, the strike actually ends peacefully when the company agrees to give higher pay and also agrees that they wouldn't punish anyone who had participated in the strike. Now, the Industrial Workers of the World, known as the IWW, they're a much more organization, much more radical organization, I should say. They supported the concept of socialism, which means that all business and industry should be run by the national government, or at the very least heavily, heavily, heavily regulated by the federal government. And so to get the American Woolen Company workers to agree to come back to work just with a wage increase, they saw as a good alternative than to continue slugging it out with a group that was promoting something as radical as socialism. Now, amidst all of what's going on, competition for employment, low wages, clashes between unions and companies, support of those companies by the federal government, you have a drastic rise in nativism. And nativism, if you remember this term, old versus new immigrant, that we have discussed in class, where old immigrants had a much easier time adjusting to life in the United States. They came from northern and western European nations, and those nations were either already English speakers or spoke a Germanic language, and English is a Germanic language in itself. So German speakers would have a tiny bit easier time learning English than someone from where new immigrants came from, which was Southern and Eastern Europe, which were much more of the Romance languages, Latin-based, or Slavic languages in Eastern Europe. And so these immigrants had a harder time assimilating, and so that was part of it. The differences between Americans and new immigrants. Part of it is just the attitude, however, of they took our jobs, or they're taking our jobs, or they're driving down our wages. And so this leads to increased nativist attitudes, keep these immigrants out of here. Leads to the Chinese Exclusion Act in 1882, lots of literacy testing during World War I, and then quota acts in the 1920s that limited the number of immigrants. And these quota acts were rather discriminatory because they allowed larger numbers, quotas, from English-speaking countries, or at least countries, again, where you could learn English a little bit better, that you would have an easier time doing what they referred to as becoming an American in this time period. They wanted that to happen quickly. They didn't want somebody to have a big, long struggle with becoming assimilated. And in this system of immigrants from lots of new places, a lot of them come and live in ethnic neighborhoods. And it makes sense that they would, right? Because if they're having a hard time assimilating to life in the United States, they would naturally want to be around others who are going through the same struggles, others who they can depend on for support and to support themselves, these others. This leads to ethnic rivalries, even gangs in major cities. A good depiction of this is the gangs of New York. And again, ethnic rivalries are well depicted in a particular film, The Untouchables. It stars Kevin Costner as Elliot Ness, an agent looking to try to get Al Capone charged with various crimes. And long story short, he forms a team, and some of the members of that team are Irish, others are Italian, and there's some ethnic rivalry there that they kind of need to get over before they can be a successful team together. And lastly, I just want to show this chart, the differences between old and new immigrants, which we discussed on the last slide. But here is a very nice chart. It will be included in your notes, and so really helped or helps to summarize the reasons for nativism, which can really be referred to as like anti-immigration. That is the end of the Chapter 16 lecture. If you have any questions, by all means, reach out. Otherwise, I will see you in class.